Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship.
Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Ed Schenick. I'm the pastor here at Monroeville United Methodist Church, and we're so glad that you're here as we got ourselves connected on Facebook from the Monroeville Park West. And we've got a group that's out here of hearty worshipers in the midst of a day that's a little bit cloudy, a little bit chilly, but absolutely beautiful. And we are so glad that you've joined us from home and are part of our worship today. As we gather together, we're going to have some gathering music. If you want to get us a cup of coffee, if you're at home, or just take a breath here. And as we're gathering, I wondered if you'd do something a little different this week. If you would, here at the park, and I've already kind of talked to you guys a little bit about that, get your cell phones out and dial up Facebook if you can do that and take a look at the chat and welcome one another. And you online at home, you're already there on Facebook or at, on the media that you're seeing it through. And just go to the chat, if you would, and just welcome one another in the peace of Christ. Because we're one community, and that's a wonderful, wonderful gift that God gives us through the medium of social media and being online. As we gather together this morning, we're going to be talking about hope and finding hope in the midst of all times. Both those high times and the difficult times. We can see hope, and we can be hope. As we begin our time as our worship, I'd like us to think of a song of hope that has been in the church for a long, long time. It's called I'll Fly Away. So glad morning when this life is over. Come to praise God, to say hallelujah. Praise the Lord for the wonderful things that God has given to us. This song is very simple. Alle, alle, alleluia. And that's it. We praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Alle, alle, alleluia. Alle, alle, alle. Alleluia, 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 allelu spirit out here. This is my We're so glad you joined us from home, and so glad you joined us out here at the park. It's nice to be back out, isn't it? So as we worship, I just want to just touch on just a few things. We are looking for some folks to help us promote our preschool. If you're in the Monroeville area, we're passing out some signs. If you put them out in your roadway, we would appreciate that. Your driveway, not the roadway, but the driveway, or the parkway, or wherever you are. Anyway, we can get kids in. It would be wonderful. And there's some other things that we'll be talking about a little later on. There's some ways that we can touch the world with hope, and sometimes in very simple ways. So we'll be sharing those as we gather together. As we come together now, I'd like you to think about hope in a little different way. Sometimes the roads aren't that smooth. And our praise song this morning is what happens when the weather gets rough in our lives. When our feet may feel like they'll fail, there's a God who's with us. Let us join together in praise.
You call me out upon the world.
Loving God, as we enter into this new week, may we feel your presence in all of our waters. May we feel your strength, see your hope, and be moved in your ways, that others may feel your presence through us in this time. Attune our hearts to you and lift us, that we may be your people this week, wherever you send us. In Jesus' name, amen. As we continue our worship this morning, is a time for our children, and I think I saw Tricia. There, hi there, Tricia. Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. So, I have something to admit this morning. This 9 o'clock service was a little early for me, and I was rushing around trying to get here on time, and I didn't get a chance to eat breakfast. So I am feeling a little hungry, and I brought myself a little snack. I hope no one minds if I just take a little couple nibbles of my snack. And it's a little embarrassing because I didn't bring enough for all of you, but I do have some extra. So if any of you are interested, I wouldn't mind sharing. Let me see what I have here. Oh, here we go. Some sweet strained peas. Any interest? I have an extra spoon in here, I promise. No? Oh, what am I thinking? It's morning. Nobody wants peas in the morning. That's silly. Okay, here we go. Here's something more breakfast appropriate. Apples and bananas. Anyone? No? See, maybe a couple of takers there. Of course not, because baby food is for babies. And we're all big grown-ups and grown-up kids, and we have different things that we like. Babies eat baby food to grow strong, and then when they get bigger and older, they start to have different tastes, and they get teeth, and they're able to eat some different kinds of food. And I'm guessing that some of you have some different grown-up foods that you like, maybe like pizza or ice cream or French fries. And that reminds me a little of the scripture that Pastor Ed is going to share with all of us this morning. And in that scripture, we hear from Paul, who is writing a big, long letter to the Ephesians. And in that letter, the part that we'll hear today is a little bit of a prayer. And that prayer talks about how happy and excited he is that the Ephesians have followed Jesus' commandment to love one another. But Paul also prays that the Ephesians and all of us as disciples of Jesus too will continue to grow in our relationship with him. Now, you might wonder, how do we grow in our relationship with Jesus? Well, sometimes when people first get to know Jesus, we say that they're born again, kind of like baby Christians. And when you're a baby, you do things that help you to learn a little bit more and to grow a little bit more. And it's the same for Christians. We start off by going to Sunday school and maybe relearning to recite some prayers that we say over food or before we go to bed at night. And then as we continue to grow and learn more about Jesus, we go to church, we learn to read our Bible, and we may even participate in the worship service by singing in the choir or maybe even giving testimony or witness. That means when you stand up and you talk about all the wonderful things that Jesus is doing in your life. And when we do those things, it's kind of like we get the spiritual food that our souls need to grow and to become closer and closer with Jesus. And when we're able to do those things, then we can speak light and truth and all talk about all the wonderful, amazing ways that Jesus is moving and living in our lives. And that is the good news for this week. Can we put our hands together and pray? Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for baby food that reminds us that we can always continue to grow closer and closer in our relationship with you. Be with all your children this week. Help us to find ways that we can find spiritual nourishment in the world around us. In your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Trisha. I was hoping we'd have enough for everybody, but I love the way that you led into the whole idea of giving thanks and seeing God. And I want to just take a little bit of time this morning as we gather out here to give thanks. In our usual worship services pre-COVID, we would be passing a plate. We call it the collection. And by the way, we do give thanks to you for the gifts that you bring and that you give to our ministry. Actually, as we are going through this time, we've been able to increase ministries. We've been adding technology. We've been able to move forward and touch people's lives and support them in the midst of the pandemic. We supported families, supported food pantries. We're seeking to reach out and make a difference in the world around us for the love of Christ. Your gifts help us to do that. And so if you would like to give to our ministry here at Monroeville United Methodist Church, they'll be on the chat line there, a link that you can go in and give if you wish to. And we do appreciate those gifts. But beyond those gifts, even there, we have people who give their time and their gifts, and we share and give thanks for those. What are the things in your life that you give thanks for this week? Where are the places that God has touched your life? Let's take a moment and think about those. Loving God, open our eyes. For as we see the gifts, as we feel the love of others, we feel your presence. Thank you. For underneath all of this day and the gift of life, you breathe life. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us continue our giving thanks with the music offering.
Ancient words ever true.
We join now in prayer, and our prayer song is itself a prayer. Shine on us. Lord, let your light, the light of your face, shine on us. Lord, let your grace, the grace from your hand, fall on us. Lord, let your love, a love with no end, come over us. As we pray, we connect with God, and as we connect with God, we connect with one another. So as we sing, you'll notice there'll be a time where we will pause and just play softly. If you're joining us online, we invite you at that point, and actually if you're here and you still have your phones out and tuned into Facebook, on chat to lift up those people who are concerned to you. And as you're watching those on the chat, I'm going to invite you at home to pray for them and hear that we remember the connection of a God who is with us, a God of love, a God of hope, and a God of grace. Let us come together in prayer. Cover your ears.
Right here, I got it.
And welcome to the world for Adelaide, Grace, Farako, proud parents of Mike and Carly. So wonderful to have and see the miracle of new birth. We want to say welcome to the world to Noah Wilson Boothby and the our parents, Justin and Lauren. And Lord, we give you thanks for the wonder of new life. Surround these families with your blessing. We celebrate that there are dropping infection rates in the United States, here in Allegheny County and in PA, but Lord, we're mindful that there are many places where that is not the case, especially in India and Brazil. And we're mindful that even though the cases may be dropping around us, dropping isn't gone. And there are many who are still battling with this. And there are medical people reaching out. Bring your healing, your grace. We lift up prayers for a just peace in Jerusalem. And with all the violence, Lord, that your grace would enter in. Especially for the many suffering civilians, the men, the women, the children. Lord, teach us that we're to be peacemakers and how to be peacemakers. We lift up Geneva, Candace, I see Marlene, and baby Melissa, who we've been praying for and is improving, and Allison is improving as well. We give you thanks.
Lord.
children said. Amen. Well, as Tricia has introduced very well, I might add, has introduced you to our scripture reading this morning, Paul is praying. He's talking to the church and writing to the church in Ephesians, and he's telling them that he's praying for them, and he tells them what he's praying for. I'll be reading from Ephesians 1, chapter 15 through 23. Let us open our hearts that we might hear God's word for us. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks to you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for those of us who believe according to the workings of his great power. God put his power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. He has put all things under his feet, and has made him head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Paul is praying for the church, and I believe the church not just in Ephesus, I believe Paul is also praying for the church of all time, for a spirit of wisdom, for a spirit of revelation, for growth as we continue to move forward. And what struck me as I was reading this passage was this phrase, with the eyes of your heart enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which God has called you. When the eyes of our heart is enlightened, I love that piece. What would you see if the eyes of your heart were enlightened? Paul is praying that they would see with the soul, that they would see beyond the physical, that they would see the power of God's Spirit working in and among and behind all things, and in that find hope. But what would that be? I'd like you to join me in thinking about that question this morning and what we might be able to do this week to open the eyes of our souls that we might see hope. What would the eyes of the heart see when God touches our heart and opens them? See, I think one of the things that we see are the infinite spiritual possibilities that are inherent in every time and every place, because God is there. See, I don't think we have a grasp sometimes of what God has created in us and the possibilities. We lose sight of the possibilities. You know, we only use a bit of our body and its potential. Actually, as I get older, I'm noticing I'm using less and less of it. But there's still potential there, and I look out and I see those who are older than I am, and yet they're out there running, they're out there doing things. There's a potential, Ed, in your body that you still have, and it's true in any place where you are. In your mind, there is a potential. We only use a portion of our mind's potential. I don't know, I was thinking about this illustration, and this is going to date me, but I remember when I was in high school and we went into the computer room. You guys remember the computer room? For those of you of younger generations, there was a time when a computer filled the entire room or at least a wall. I remember coming in and they had set aside this room and the entire wall was computer, and they had these you know, tape things moving around, right? And they had this little keyboard and this little screen, and it probably had less power than our current calculators, but it took up everything. Some of my friends were computer majors. Remember punching the cards and having to get them all in line? You know, the potential as it began to move forward. And now take a look at this. This morning, we just got online and connected with people all around the country and potentially all around the world in the flash of a second with a computer 5 times more powerful that we hold in our hands. Do you realize the potential? And what Paul is saying is that it's not just our body that has potential. It's not just our minds that has potential. Our souls have potential. And we don't tap the potential of our souls. What would happen if we began to see with the eyes of the soul? We begin to see the potential that God is putting in our lives to make a difference of love and of grace and of peace and all the things we see in Jesus. We touch one another's soul, and God can use us to do that. Some of you, years ago, we had this study we used to call Network. And Network was a spiritual inventory. We used to take an inventory of what we thought we could do and that kind of stuff. And as part of that, where do we see God moving and where are our gifts? And then we would give a piece of paper with a listing of, you know, give me a feedback of where you see the gifts. And I remember every time I taught that course, the thing that was interesting to me are the people that would come back and they would say, I never saw this in me, but other people saw it in me. See, when we see with the eyes of the soul, we see potential in others, and we share that as good news. Do you know what you have in you? Because sometimes we don't see it. I remember in one of the churches I did this, and it was our organist who plays piano beautifully, played organ beautifully. And she passed out this sheet, and someone came back and said, you know, what are your spiritual gifts? We don't think of it as spiritual. And what came back was music. And she said, you know, the craziest thing about it is I always knew I loved music. I always knew I enjoyed playing music. I never saw music as a way that God was working in me. God was touching other people through me, and I didn't even know it. That's the potential. The potential that God puts into you and me when we see with the eyes of the soul. See, what else would we see with the eyes of the soul? See, he goes, what you would see, having the eyes of your heart enlightened that you may know the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. That we're part of something big. When we see with the eyes of the soul, it isn't just me and Jesus. It's me and Jesus and the world. It's me and Jesus in a community in the kingdom of God. And so often I think we see the kingdom of God as something that happens in the by and by. I'll fly away. But we've missed the kingdom of God when we're in the midst of this world, in this time, in this place, in the midst of the oceans, in the midst of the times when our feet may fail and we're afraid we don't see the presence of God and the community of faith that surrounds us. Do you realize the gift of being in the community of faith, in the kingdom of God? You're part of a special community. It's not an exclusive community, but it's a special community. And it's all around the world. We were having a seminar yesterday on both and, trying to learn how as a church to begin to reach out at the same time, both online and here. And we're learning and we're growing. Talk about baby food and learning. God always has something new for you to learn. And it was interesting as the person was sharing with us at the conference center said, you need to realize something as a professional. I know that this has been difficult, but as community of faiths, I have never seen the likes of what's happened over the last year of how churches adapted, looked for creative ways to reach out beyond the walls, to share the gospel. I was thinking in our church of devotions daily for a while. That our lay leaders stepped up, and we did that because we knew people needed hope in the midst of it. And we learned Mevos. We're still learning. We're learning on the curve. And learning about how to begin to Zoom and begin to bring the gospel in different ways. Do you realize you're part of that community and the potential of that? In the midst of this COVID time, the church has risen up. And we've risen up with love. You're not alone. You're not alone. And it's not just a community that's here. It's a community that's all around the world. Do you realize what a special gift that is? I don't think that ever hit me. I mean, I always went to church. We had Worldwide Communion Sunday, and we thought about, you know, there's Christians all over the world that are praying, and I had it up here, but I didn't have it down here until I had a real gift. God sent me on a journey to Kenya when I was a senior in college, and I worked with the National Christian Council of Kenya. It was a part of our internship. That sounded a bit morbid, not the way I wanted to go with that at all. Anyways, but it was an internship, and I remember going there. They sent me to Fraha Toys, which was a toy making company, and they taught people in the middle of this desolate area outside of Kenya how to work with their hands and do woodworking so that they could find jobs. And they were designing toys, and I came in with the name, it's a German name, and so it was started by a German company, so the people there thought I was the overseer from the overhead company. So I walked in as a student, right, and I said, well, this is really wonderful, and they gave me an office, and oh, Mr. Schenick, we're doing this, and this, and this, and this, and then my head of our program called up and said, did our student get there yet? And the next thing I knew, I was sanding puzzle pieces, right? So anyways, I'm out there sanding, lost the office, maybe someday, who knows, but I'm sanding puzzle pieces with the community, and they began to talk about their faith. There were Christians that were around in that table, and they began sharing to me their native language, and I learned all about Kikuyu. I never knew how to speak Kikuyu. And I remember as we closed off the day, we would go and we would worship, and we would close the worship with the Lord's Prayer. And as we were all praying, people prayed in their own languages. There were missionaries there from Germany, and I heard German, I heard Spanish, I heard Italian. Obviously, I heard Swahili. I heard the tribal languages, and it was interesting. The words were all different because they were different languages, but the cadence was the same. And you knew in that rhythm, it was the rhythm of God. And I was part of it. Do you realize the gift that you're being given in the kingdom of God? When we open our eyes with the eyes of our soul, when God opens that, we see that we're part of something bigger. And not just here. We see ourselves as part of something bigger. I will fly away. There is a time of hope. We are passing through. No matter what it is that we're dealing with, it will pass. My mom and dad, mom had MS. My dad used to take care of her, and they went through some really difficult times. And one of the phrases that they gave me that I always appreciated was this: this too shall pass. Amen? We are passing through, and there is a God that will take you through whatever it is you're with. Even when it comes to that time when we leave this world. One of the great gifts I had in the midst of COVID, in the midst of difficult times, God is there. We had an elderly member of our congregation pass away. She was married to a Catholic husband who had passed before her. And she left two requests. One, that we did communion at graveside. There was a mausoleum there, and that her family could be present, and we spaced out as best as we could. And we couldn't pass communion the way we normally would do, and we did some things a little differently. But the thing I wanted you to think about was this. In the church, we have this communion rail that we are around, right? And I had a friend of mine say, you know, that's the beginning of a symbol, that when we come to the rail, we're coming to Christ's table, and you know how that rail comes over and hits the wall in the sanctuaries, right? But actually, with eyes of the soul and eyes of the heart, that railing keeps going behind the wall and goes around. And there are the people that have gone before us. They're in the body of Christ, and they're kneeling on the other side. We're connected. And the interesting thing about that, I've always used that image, but it never hit me more starkly than when I'm sitting in a mausoleum and right behind me are the communion of saints. Her very family that had gone before her. And I kept thinking of that piece in Revelation where they're gathered up and they're worshiping God. And who are these? These are those who have gone through the great ordeal. They've washed their blood, their clothes in the blood of the Lamb. And they're praying. They're praying for those who are still in the ordeal, for you and me. Do you realize the gift you're being given? No matter where you are, there are people praying for you. Their spiritual mothers and fathers are still praying for you. I want you to think about that this week. And as we begin to take some time for that spiritual food, we feed everything else. And Lord knows I feed my body way too much. Am I feeding my soul? Some things that you can do, as you look in through our email blast, we have places where you can gather in small groups online, and you can join with us and with communities of faith to share faith and build our faith. We're looking for people to be able to help out with our kids. See, it starts with kids. If you've got some children in your family, we've got camps, and the information is there. Get involved with that. Get your kids involved with camp. We're looking for people to volunteer with our VBS. I know that Amanda would love to have some volunteers as we begin to teach faith. But mostly, I think it begins in prayer. Paul is praying that God would open the eyes of their heart. I think that's where we need to begin today. And through this week, let us pray. Let us pray that God would open the eyes of our hearts, that we might remember the gift and share it. Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, open the eyes of our hearts. Open our souls that we may see you underneath everything. And may we hear your call and respond, for you are the God of hope. May we be people of hope to your world this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As we close with a song of hope. Let us all rise if you're here. You can rise at home, too, if you want to. This is a wonderful song. Take a stretch. We'll see how these guitars are in tune at the end of this. We'll see how it goes. It's chilly out here. Ready?
May the God of hope go with us every day, filling all our lives with love and joy and peace. May the God of justice lead us on our way, bring light and mercy every night and day. Praying for us, work the peace, singing, share our joy to all. Working for a world that's new, faithful, and we hear Christ's call.
Let me try and sing that one more time. Brothers, sisters, friends in Christ, know that God goes with you wherever you go. The one who created you, the one who has redeemed you, will sustain you. Let us open the eyes of our souls and let us share that love, that all may come to know the good news of Jesus Christ. Let all God's children say,
amen.
Amen. Have a great week, everybody.